Why aren't we wearing our snowsuits?
Show up in snow gear.
In a few moments, you're going to speak these words to each other. Before we get to that moment, I would just invite you to greet people. To be aware of the presence of those who love you and have come to this place to be with you, and to ponder the nature of the life and the nature of the love that you are promising to share with one another for the rest of your days in this world. The reading that you had your mother offer in this service from 1 John 4 offers one of the most beautiful visions and articulations of the nature of love that has ever been put to pen. We trust and believe that this divine love, in a very deep and mysterious way, has already guided you in your lives, every moment of your lives, in fact, has guided you to be in this place together today, has guided you to find love and friendship with each other, and has guided you to make the decision to come to this place today and to make the decision to love each other for the rest of the days of your lives. The passage also articulates, however, the great mystery that lies at the heart of this powerful vision. That is that none of us have ever actually seen God. None of us have ever fully understood this great mystery. The presence of God's love, instead, according to the passage, is actually made real in our actions, in the tangible world, in the very physical, visible realities of our lives. The passage suggests that this great love is revealed most fully in the life of Jesus. But the passage also makes a claim that should be a challenge before you today. The challenge is this: no one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and God's love is perfected in us. In other words, your calling in this life and in your relationship with each other is to allow that divine mystery, to allow that love to live fully in you and to shape every part of who you are and to influence every moment of the life that you share together. The problem, of course, is that all this is easier said than done. For all of our talk about love, for all of the cards that you're going to receive today, about love, for all of the good wishes that all of us wish you today, the reality is that life in a relationship of such committed and deep love is not always going to be easy. But the wisdom and the beauty of the wedding vow that you are about to make is that in and through all of those different times, you are standing up, you are having the courage to stand before the world and say, this is the person with whom I want to share all the good times and all the bad times, all the richness and all the poverty, all the sickness and all the health, all the moments, good and bad, that now lie before us. Neither of you can do this alone. Neither of you can fulfill this promise just by yourselves. You can only do so as long as both of you remain committed to the promise that you are about to make. The substance of that promise should remind you that love is far more than some nice, sentimental, gushy, romantic notion that you have today. Rather, what you will need to remember, and what you will continue to have to keep in your minds and hearts, is that that love requires a decision that you make each and every day. Remember that. If you remember nothing else of what I say right now, remember this, that your love for each other is a decision that you are making. It is the decision to be patient in the midst of conflict. It is the decision to forgive when you have been wronged. It is the decision to be faithful in times of temptation and indifference, the decision to be gentle in words and actions and thoughts, even when anger and rage might otherwise overcome you, the decision to go out of your way each and every day to make the other feel completely loved and honored and cherished and respected, the decision to say thank you, to express gratitude, not just for the big things, but for those small, everyday things that you might otherwise take for granted. The decision to consider the other's feelings and needs and sensitivities and preferences alongside, and sometimes even before you consider your own. It takes a conscious and intentional decision to live in that type of love, and it's not always going to be easy, but it is that decision to love each other, the decision to remain committed to each other at every moment, that will indeed make the relationship that you have with each other the deepest and the most satisfying relationship that you will ever have in this life. It is this decision that will allow your life together and your marriage to be a light in this world that so dearly needs to see that light, that so dearly needs to know that that love can be made real. Ultimately, I'd encourage you to remember that the ultimate expression of that divine, self-giving love was revealed in a story of forgiveness. When there was no fancy wedding clothes or elaborate romantic music playing, but rather when a man was nailed to a crude wooden cross upon which the world witnessed an act of incredible nonviolence in the face of evil, an act of vulnerable compassion, an act of life-giving self-sacrifice, which unexpectedly revealed the full power of God's death-defying love. We pray this day that your love for each other is going to be modeled on that ancient story. We pray that your love will be filled with forgiveness, with compassion, with self-sacrifice, with life-giving but death-defying love. Jeff and Melanie, as you make these promises to each other, seeking the blessing of God upon your common life, it is our prayer that God's love will inspire you to make the decision each day to love each other fully and completely, to forgive each other and cherish each other and grow old together in a lifetime filled with joy and great memories, and wonderful experiences, and most importantly, with a love that will never end. May the God of love bless you as you speak these words, and may the God of love continue to bless you as you live out this promise today and for the rest of your life together. Amen.
Amen.
Beloved, let us love one another, for God so loved is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. With love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. God is love, and those who abide in his love abide in God, and God abides in them.
Melanie, in the name of God.
Melanie, in the name of God.
I take you to be my wife.
I take you to be my wife.
From this time onward.
From this time onward.
To join with you.
To join with you.
And to share all that is to come.
And to share that all is all to come.
To give and to receive.
To give and to receive.
To speak and to listen.
To speak and to listen.
To inspire and to respond.
To inspire and respond.
And in all our life together.
In all our life together.
To be loyal to you with my whole being.
To be loyal to you with my whole being.
For as long as we both shall live.
For as long as we both shall live.
Melanie, please repeat after me.
From this time onward.
To join with you.
To join with you.
To share all that is to come.
And to share all that is to come.
To give and to receive.
To give and to receive.
To speak and to listen.
To speak and to listen.
To inspire and to respond.
To inspire and to respond.
And in all our life together.
And in all our life together.
To be loyal to you.
To be loyal to you
with my whole being.
With my whole being.
For as long as we both shall live.
For as long as we both shall live.
Place the ring on Jeff's finger and repeat after me. Jeff, I give you this ring.
Jeff, I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my promise.
As a symbol of my promise.
I acknowledge you as my partner.
I acknowledge you as my partner.
For the rest of my life.
For the rest of my life.
You are my beloved.
You are my beloved.
With all that I am.
And with all that I am.
And all that I ever shall be.
And with all that I ever shall be.
I love and honor you.
I love and honor you.
Jeff, please place the ring on Melanie's finger and repeat after me. Melanie, I give you this ring.
Melanie, I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my promise.
As a symbol of my promise.
I acknowledge you as my partner.
I acknowledge you as my partner.
For the rest of my life.
For the rest of my life.
You are my beloved.
You are my beloved.
And with all that I am.
With all that I am.
And all that I ever shall be.
And all that I shall ever be.
I love and honor you.
I love and honor you.
Jeff and Melanie, in exchanging these vows and these rings, you've now committed yourselves to each other, a charge to fulfill the promise that you have made in the presence of God and in the presence of all of us. Be patient and humble. Be kind and considerate with one another. Forgive as you have been forgiven by God. Laugh together and cry together. Celebrate all of the joys of life together and be there for each other in times of challenge and difficulty. Grow old together. And above all else, each and every day, make the decision to love each other with every part of who you are. Because in the name of Jesus Christ, who is the only King and Head of the Church, and by virtue of the authority vested in me by the province of Ontario, I do pronounce you to be husband and wife. Those whom God has joined together, let no one separate. Letter of the Corinthians, we find these words, live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a good peace.
absolute pleasure to be part of the service today. As a minister, every once in a while, you get to do weddings for people who are friends and people who you value, cherish, and respect greatly. And many of those people are actually in this room tonight, members of St. Andrews. But Melanie and Jeff are a very special couple, and I don't have to convince any of you of that. It is a pleasure to be with both of you today, and we're actually thrilled to celebrate this wonderful day with you. So I'd like to just invite you to join me in a prayer of thanksgiving for food and friendship and the gift of love in this world that you best with music. Let's pray for it. Loving God, we thank you for the gift of life. We thank you for the gift of love. We thank you for food to sustain our lives and friends to sustain our souls. We thank you for Jeff and Melanie, the love and friendship that they found with each other, for the joy and peace that we see in them when we're together. Bless them, bless this evening, bless our shared conversations and this time together. Allow us in all things to know the presence of your love at work among us and within us, and allow us to go from this place to love this world that you so desperately love. Also pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. In case you haven't guessed, I'm the groom's little brother. The upgrade, if you will.
Yeah.
I can be the artist's masterpiece. Jeff's the rough sketch, rough being the operative word. I first met Jeff when I got home from Northside Hospital. Jeffrey and I have shared many adventures over the years, including teaching me to ride his first snowmobile.
Aww.
He didn't even get angry at me when I just crashed it just a short time later. I still recall writing a note to Jeffrey, explaining why the next new sled was taken apart in the garage. He was at a friend's house that evening, and, well, had a little mishap. Anyway, I wrote him a note that evening and explained, basically to Jeff, that I would take care of it, I would fix it. Jeff, I still recall you reading that note, and it was with great patience he said, "That's okay, it can be fixed. I'm glad you're okay." And this is a true testament to Jeff's character.
Here, here.
We've enjoyed each other's companies on many camping trips and other outdoor adventures over the years. We are fortunate to have a wonderful system where we work together, and we share many of our work skills, whether it's doing renovations around the house or working on each other's cars or trucks. It's fair to say that as brothers, we don't always see eye to eye growing up, but any grief we gave each other was often offset, or always offset, sorry, by the bond between us. Jeff says the treatment he doled out sometimes towards me as kids was to help round my character, and maybe it did help. So about 2 years ago, I noticed that Jeff seemed to be busier than normal. And kind of missing in action, if you will.
Yeah.
In hindsight, seems kind of correlated with the time you met Melanie. Before I go on with my story, though, I must first talk about Jeff's love for Toyota Camrys. I'll keep you short. I've grown up in a family where there's always been a Toyota Camry, and currently we have a total of 9. Anyway, Jeff's first car was a 1993 Toyota Camry that he purchased at the age of 17 from my grandparents, grandma and grandpa. The 1993 Toyota Camry is still his favorite car, which he insists is broken out in a mere 480,000 and 25 years young. So when we were discussing the arrangements for transportation to the wedding and what he'd drive on this wedding day, and get Melanie here in her wonderful dress. He said, "Oh, I'll take the Camry." However, he confessed one night recently that he'd have to do some preparations. He thought he should wipe some of the polysporin from the body of the car. Now, this polysporin is actually greased to cover up the rust spots, which are disappearing on the car for some reason or another. So back to my story. When I first heard of Melanie one day, it was when I was over at Jeff's house, back in his shop. He was busy putting away his kayaks. He explained to me he'd just been out on a first date at Kelso Conservation Area. He was summarizing the important details of the date, of course. You know, that she drives a Toyota Corolla and can fly. My thoughts are, wow, she's really brave to go kayaking with Jeff. Especially on a first date. Melanie, may I remind you of my experiences with Jeff? On a more recent trip, whitewater rafting, as we prepared to enter a new section of the rapids, the guide yells to us, "Stay to the right." Of course, Jeff says, "Oh, the left side looks more interesting." After that, the next thing I recall was going through that section of rapids underneath the raft. Melanie, I urge you, if you're ever going to be in the... I'm sorry.
Tell the story!
I urge you, if you're ever going to be out on the water with Jeff, make sure you're in the back to steer, especially if whitewater is involved. On that trip, we also went down the wrong fork in the river, but I'll let Jeff tell you more about that story at another time. Jeff, I'm very glad that you've met somebody who enjoys outdoor adventures and sightseeing and exploring as much as he does. From the time I met Melanie, she's always greeted us with a smile on her face. From the moment she enters the room to the moment she makes her goodbyes. She's funny, smart, outgoing, and let's not forget, intelligent and handy. I really admire Jeff and Melanie's ability to work together to accomplish a task. Whether it's painting a bedroom or a larger project like assembling a full sawmill, this is a true testament to their ability to work together. I'm sure for those of you who saw the two big skids of parts for the sawmill and the 400-page manual, you too would agree. Melanie and Jeff truly bring out the best in each other, encouraging each other's curiosities, supporting each other through the tough times, and cheering each other on always. Jeffrey, thank you for being such a great friend and an even better brother. I look forward to seeing what your future holds and helping in any way I can. Melanie, I think we would all agree that you're extra stunning this evening, and Jeffrey has really won the lottery.
Yeah.
Wow.
I'm very excited to say I would like to kindly ask everybody to raise their glass. I would like to propose a toast to Melanie and Jeffrey. Today we celebrate you as a couple. We wish you a lifetime of happiness, love, health, success, and laughter. May you continue to find humor in the bad and an appreciation for the good. May your friendship continue to grow throughout the years to come. Cheers.
Hi, my name is Kim, and I'm so excited to be Melanie's maid of honor. We first met at the University of Western Ontario in 2007. She was starting her master's in neuroscience, and I was beginning mine in clinical psychology. We became the best of friends and have remained that way ever since. Melanie is a one-of-a-kind gal. How many people do you know who have donated blood over 25 times, is an elder in her church, is a half-marathon finisher, won first prize in a lemon loaf contest, designed a brand new food science course at college and then taught it, and has the most amazing flexible toes, a new talent that I recently observed at her bachelorette. But a superstar. Melanie is the person I call when I want to celebrate or when I'm having a tough moment. I remember calling her when I was having a super crappy week. I had been in two minor car crashes in 2 days, only one of which was my fault. Through my tears, she managed to cheer me up and had me laughing by the end of the conversation. Mal, thank you for making me and everyone who knows you a better person. Thank you for endless nights of watching Bachelorette, always being game to share Greek salad at our favorite diner, bargain hunting at thrift shops with me, and for always making Eddie Freddy time, our nicknames toward one another. Mel, I'm so happy that you found the love of your life. As I've gotten to know Jeff and his wonderful family, I could think of no better partner for you. Jeff is patient, hardworking, close with his family, and most of all, he makes you the happiest I've ever seen you. In the words of my favorite author, Dr. Seuss, Jeff and Mel, you have brains in your head, you have feet in your shoes, you can steer yourself in any direction you choose. You're off to great places. Today is your day. Your mountain is awaiting, so go get on your way. I would like to now ask our wonderful bridesmaids, Christine, Soleil, and Julianne, to join me for a couple words.
Thank you. jet strategy because I threatened to make it a very long speech. I've got a whole whack of pages here. So I think that's why they set it up that I was talking during the dinner so I didn't bug you guys too much. No, just kidding. It's going to be a very short speech, hitting on some of the high points. Now, I'm sure you've been at weddings where the parents have had some very embarrassing pictures of their kids when they were, you know, at various life stages. Well, for some reason, that's probably why we don't have a projector here. Maybe Melanie didn't want some of those pictures. So I'll have to create some word pictures instead. But seriously now, it's not going to be too embarrassing at all. Don't worry, relax. It's a great pleasure to be standing here tonight. I bring greetings from Trognukram. I can remember like yesterday holding Melanie like this and fitting from here to here. And when I look at her now, I don't think any of you would think, wow, was she really that small? And it just shows you the miracle of growth. Another part of parenting involves a lot of firsts. I remember her first uniform in South Africa where we grew up, taking her shopping for her first uniform. Well, fast forward to today where she's wearing her outfit on a uniform and it's absolutely gorgeous. I think you're all agree. So. And another one of those firsts, we immigrated 25 years ago, and I remember that very clearly too. And so today we see Melanie as a fine South African Canadian. And so Jeff, I guess that was part of the grand design those 25 years ago to bring an international bride to you, not just an eHarmony bride. I've always been aware, and Tim can probably tell you his own stories about her smarts and determination. When we landed 25 years ago, Melanie was sick, and must have been something about the plane food or something. I mean, not a big surprise. And she was just tossing her cookies, puking, and she was so worried about being a bother. And I'm saying, really? You know, you're getting sick already. You know, don't worry about it. Well, those are going to be great qualities, and Jeff, you're kind of lucky with that, with her determination. You've got a very hard-working woman. Sometimes dial it back a little, okay? Don't forget to spend time with each other, but that determination, we all have struggles in relationships and so on, even the best ones. Jeff, you've got a good starting point. The tradition that I started when I used to travel quite a lot, I would bring Melanie a teddy bear. I brought it back, laser cut teddy bears. I don't know where she found space to store them. Maybe they're packed away in a box somewhere. But obviously as she grew up, that tradition came to an end. So instead, Melanie, you've got a real live teddy bear, a great big teddy bear. She's always been ready to take on new things, see new places. At one point, she took up trumpet playing in the school band. Can you imagine? That's really called tooting your own horn, right? But as part of that celebration, taking on new things, that's the whole reason why we're here, eating a fabulous meal. And Melanie was asking how we were doing. There's no doubt, I don't think there's an unhappy face in the place. So you guys have done a great job. Thank you. And it's awesome to celebrate. So it's great to be here celebrating as you guys move to this new phase. So you'll be seeing things and new things and doing new things. So I've often told you how proud I am of you. So I want to reinforce, it's been a joy seeing you as a beautiful brother. Congratulations.
Newfound relationship. In the 90s, I got an email from Beryl, and in it was an essay that Melanie had written when she was 14, and it was her very strong views on life at that stage. And there was one paragraph headed, "My Husband." And unfortunately, I mislaid the email, so I can't tell you much, but in it she did say that he must be taller than her, and I think Jeff just makes it. And also that he must have a gentle heart. So when I find the email, I'll send it to you, we'll see. To end off with, I see in you, Jeff, fulfilling many of Melanie's dreams. So as your South African family, Jeff and Melanie, we wish you very well. Our prayers will always be with you, as they have been. And we look forward to connecting with you both on South African soil.
Sent me into a panic of editing and cutting if I had had any idea this morning about what I was going to talk about. But I wasn't given any guidelines, so I'm going to go back to the beginning as far as I am concerned with Melanie. I first met Melanie when, at the end of a business trip that I had to Toronto, and I went down and visited her family. And since then, I formed a relationship with her mother and got to know Melanie. She was a teenager. She was loving. She was obnoxious, she was friendly, she was obstreperous, a teenager. Not too much different from Tim, although they were totally different in their approach. No worse, no better, but a teenager. As time went by, I attended her graduation from Air Cadets, and I saw this magnificent young woman marching in parade with her friends and colleagues and fellow cadets. And I was amazed, she can fly. I work for the U.S. Federal Aviation Administration, but I have nothing to do with keeping airplanes in the air so you can fly with some assurance. I was impressed. Now they say that when a young man in the U.S. at least goes to university, he is convinced that his parents are the most ignorant people in the world. But when he comes back in 4 years, he is absolutely amazed at how much they've learned in those 4 years. Well, there's also a change in the person going to university. So when Melanie went, her mother and I kept contact with her as much as we could. Her mother followed me to the U.S. to live. And I saw this marvelous young woman growing and blossoming. It wasn't really a surprise because the seeds were there. But she was no longer a teenager with all that implies. She was a lovely woman. And since then, she kept close contact with us, and after her mother died, she still kept close contact with us. I remember a time we came down to New Orleans and we had this lovely riverboat cruise. So, at any rate, to keep it short, and not have Millie mad at me for exceeding 3 minutes, I am proud to call Melanie my daughter. Yes, I'm a stepfather, but to me, Melanie is a daughter, and anything else is legal quibbling in a matter of genetics. She is my daughter and everything that counts, and I am proud to be Melanie's father. Jeff, you're getting a really good one. On the other hand, I don't know Jeff well. I'm hoping that for their 25th anniversary, I'll be able to tell stories, although I'll never surpass Brendan in that. But I do know enough to know that Melanie's getting a good one. So I will say that both of you, in the best sense of the word, really deserve each other. And I hope that you will live as long as you love, and love as long as you live. I love you.
Family, for being here to share with us, and you've come a long way, and the words of wisdom from Melanie and Jeff.
You can hear me okay?
Yeah.
It's wonderful to be able to mark the occasion of Mel and Jeff's family, her dad Michael from Vancouver, her brother Tim from Edmonton, her stepdad Jay from Raleigh, and it's really been great to get to know Mel's mom's sister, James, who's been a riot to have. And what a pleasure it is to have Elizabeth and Murray White, Jeff's grandparents, join us.
Jim and I would really like to thank all our guests, family, and friends for helping us to celebrate Melanie and Jeff's marriage. We're so pleased that Margaret Race and her daughter Anne were able to travel from Belgium to join the party. Canada is where your true roots are, having been raised as a child with my mom in southern Manitoba. As parents, we hoped Jeff would find a partner who would love and appreciate him. So when Melanie and Jeff found each other, we were thrilled, very thrilled. And having Jeff as our firstborn child, it has been a great experience in our lives. We were both overjoyed the moment he was born. I remember the delivery doctor saying to us, "You're happy now, but that might change when he's a teenager." Reflecting on what was said at his birth, Jim and I have to say to Jeff that we're proud to have you as our son.
2 years ago, at our Easter family celebration, we were very excited to meet the woman that makes Jeff's life so complete. Melanie, now that we know you, we love you. As her firstborn, Jeff was subject to his parents' inexperience. He survived many experiments that we conducted, and has steadily grown to be his own person. When Jeff was little, he loved to use his imagination and his hands to create and build. Started with wooden toys, boxes of Legos, and a very serious collection of toy tractors, mostly green. As a sensitive and caring person, Jeff enjoys helping his friends and family when they are in need, and especially projects that involve renovating. A sledgehammer is a great place to start. Jeff's extremely practical. He uses his skills in design and creation to help others, traits that were passed on maybe from time that he spent with his great-grandfather, or his grandfather, Murray, learning how to use a hammer, saw, and measuring tape.
So Jeffrey still loves his car and tractors, but he has lots of room left in his heart to love Melanie even more. They're looking forward, I think, at this point, to spending more time together after their wedding celebration, doing what they love to do together, being outdoors, hiking the Bruce Trail, and traveling. Melanie, you are very special to us for so many reasons, including your outgoing personality, your can-do positive outlook, and also because you tolerate Jeffrey's quirks with a grin. Believe me, it's from personal experience when I say that the males in the White family have some endearing quirks. You are patient, kind, and loving, a true best friend for Jeff.
We've enjoyed watching their friendship grow in the activities that have joined them together. If an idea crops up from Mel, ever have too many of them? Then Jeff will work with her to make it happen. For example, the garden expansion. We were astonished when Jeff suddenly discovered about gardening in his backyard. The planning and the execution of their house renovations, which seem to continue.
So the first time I heard about Melanie's sense of adventure was in the winter of 2016, when Jeff told me they were planning a winter camping trip. That adventure went well, as they managed to stay warm in the tent. They must have been, well, just like two peas in a pod. Melanie and Jeff have had more grand adventures since then, far from their backyard in Western Canada, Astoria, and Eastern Canada.
So Jim and I have just a few bits of advice for you both. Separately, you are two wonderful people. Together, you're even better. You have an easy back and forth banter. You know how to make each other laugh and smile, and you know how to comfort each other well. You really are like two peas in a pod. And we hope you never lose sight of the treasures your relationship will bring you.
So following in Pat's analogy of the two peas in a pod, I think that marriage is kind of like having a garden. It takes some constant tending, sometimes very hard work, and the results are always definitely rewarding. May you always have each other to count on. Be sure to include some ingredients in your garden of patience, understanding, attentiveness to each other's thoughts, and lastly, plenty of kisses and hugs. I hope that you have a life together that's full of joy, laughter, and love. Let us all take a moment and we'll raise our glasses as we propose a toast.
To the new husband and wife, may you have enough trials to keep you strong.
Enough hope to keep you happy.
Enough success to keep you eager.
Enough friends to keep you comfortable.
Enough determination to make each day better than yesterday.
Enough happiness to keep you sweet.
Cheers to my
cheers.
It's a great honor that we have all the important people here in our lives gathered in one building. Not very often that happens. We are so blessed that you all came here to share your love and support as we got hitched.
Yes, just as Jeff said, I'm very grateful that you're here. I'm especially grateful that Jeff's here because our dear friend Doris Cox joked recently a few months back that Jeff would get cold feet and hide in her basement. But he didn't. Woo, and he made it!
Our family and friends are very important to us. Before we share a few special thank yous, we would like to take a moment to remember those who we wish could be with us today. We especially remember Melanie's mom, who is missed every day. A toast to those who are gone, but not forgotten. It may be surprising to many of you, but I don't really love the spotlight. So let's turn it on to some of you. I'd like to start by toasting my beautiful bridesmaids. Thank you for keeping my bride stress-free and happy. Thanks, ladies.
Indeed, there are so many amazing women who are, aside from Jeff, some of the great loves of my life. And I could spend all evening actually naming all of you by name, and I'm just so glad that I get to have so many great loves in my life. And just you women and men too, actually I have some great guy friends here as well, but the women especially, I can't even put into words what you mean to me. But I especially want to thank Kim and Julianne and Saleha for standing with me today, and not just today, actually for over a third of my life. So thank you for being so wonderful today and always. And then I'm also thrilled to be getting a new sister, my sister Christine. Doesn't she look lovely? Wow. He really has such wonderful adventures with you, and that's important to me. Like, I'm an independent woman, Jeff's an independent guy, we have great adventures together, but he can go and have wonderful times with you guys, and I really love that. So that's great. So I'd like to share those with all of you, all of everyone's guy friends and girlfriends that are really important to a couple for their success.
Guys up at the front, Brennan, Lloyd, Robert, and especially Tim. Thanks for helping me to make sure that the day has gone off smoothly, helping with all the small little details this morning so they all fell into place. Especially Tim.
All into place, i.e. the wedding cake. Don't worry, it's fine. And actually, it's my fault.
A special thank you to the guests that have joined us from afar. Belgium,
yay.
South Africa, the United States, and across Canada. We may have said a million times, but once again, it means so much to us. Thank you. During our relationship, our friends and family have come together as a community to provide support that's even more obvious and evident during wedding planning and the days leading up to today. Thank you to Melanie's aunt, Jean, for her tireless help, cooking, cleaning, organizing, and teaching me a few words. Thank you to our friends, Donna and Lloyd, and brothers Tim and Brendan, for setting up this beautiful venue. I also want to thank Burnside's Farms and the Bruce family for letting us use this century-old barn for our party tonight. It's an honor.
So as many of you know, seeking out nature when hiking is how Jeff and I developed our relationship and blossomed. I have personally always been drawn to flowers and greenery. It just makes me so happy to look at these things. And I just want to give a special shout out to our Aunt Susan. I'm going to cry because I'm just so overwhelmed with how you just perfectly captured the vision for today of how we can incorporate some of the things that connect us and make us happy into our day. And so I'm just really grateful. Thank you. Also like to thank you, our Minister Will, for coming all the way from Toronto. And he represents our church, but he's one of many people from my church family in Toronto, and so it has truly been a family to me, so thank you all for coming, and I hope that you will continue to have me in your family even as I transition into this new Aaron family.
Tell us how you really feel.
Thank you, Vicky, for taking photos for us, and for baking, and Grandma White also for baking cookies. And I just want to share with you, it is a little secret, but I'll let you in on my secret because I'm very bad at keeping secrets. Grandma White lent me her penny from 1916 to put in my shoe, just the way she had it in her shoe when she got married. And so I hope that it will bring us the same kind of love and love that they were. And finally for me, I just want to thank Kirstie, Claire, and Jill for the special music during our ceremony.
the handsome, intelligent, dashing son, who is athletic, wise, and a very modest man, stood before you. Over the years, my mother and father have supported me more than I deserve. I hope I have done them proud. I really couldn't ask for any better parents. Thank you for everything you have done, and I love you dearly.
We love you back.
I would also like to echo that. I cannot thank my new parents, Pat and Jim, enough for all their help with the wedding, and especially for hosting the rehearsal dinner yesterday. But it's just all of the work you put into your family as a whole, and having Jeff as your son and now he is your daughter. It's just incredible to feel like I won the in-law lottery, sort of better than I won it. So I'm so honored to be joining the White family, the whole crew. Thank you very much. And I'd like to thank my dad. And it's just, it's been, life is a journey, and we've come so far together. But I'm so glad we're on this journey together. And thank you for being here. I'd like to thank my stepdad, Jay, and his wife, Jill. I have very consciously kept up a relationship after my mom passed away, and that's because Jay is so wonderful, and he treated my mom so well. He loved her so much, and he now loves Jill just as much, and I'm so glad that Jill has also accepted me as well. So we have a great relationship, and we look forward to visiting you in Raleigh sometime.
Yes.
And I also want to thank my Aunt Jean and my Aunts Joy and Heather, who are back home, and all my family back home. And you notice I would use the word home consciously, like that is always a part of me and my home. And you can't understand me without understanding that I also come from South Africa. So we will come visit you. We have plans to come see you guys next year. But thank you for always having your doors open for us, and for Jean for coming to see us.
My dearest Melanie, as Jean would say, I got a half-smiled South African accent. Melanie. Is that right?
Yeah.
We first met each other 2.5 years ago, and I'm very proud to say she has become my best friend. I have been a good friend to her as well. Especially when I am one beautiful. That could include the various renovation projects around the home. The projects never stop, but one day I hope to complete the ever-growing list.
Don't do it, Jeff.
Not to mention, I make great coffee in the mornings to raise my sleeping beauty from her sleep. I still haven't worked out quite why she agreed to marry me, but every day I wake up happy she chose me. I really am looking forward to the rest of my life next to this amazing lady. Thank you, Melanie. Melanie. I love you in so many ways and for so many reasons. So I would just like you to join me in a toast to my beautiful bride.
Just the way you look tonight. touches my foolish heart. Lovely, don't you ever change. Keep that breathless charm. Won't you please arrange it, 'cause I love you just the way you look tonight. Just the way you look tonight.